Good morning and welcome to the Center for Strategic and International Studies. I'm Steve Johnson, Director of the Americas Program. And today's event, From the PON to the PRI, a preview of the next Sexenio, is the culmination of a project that began 2 years ago with a foundation grant that is looking at Mexico during the run-up and the aftermath of the 2012 electoral campaign, called Tracking Democracy at a Time of Uncertainty. And in fact, in 2011, there were no obvious front-runners. And even according to Duncan Wood, who's with us today, who wrote one of the first monographs in our series, the main issue seemed to be security. And after the run-up, it was the same thing, beginning on the heels of the highest spike in violent crime in Mexico's history after a U.S. customs agent had been killed and following the ill-conceived U.S. operation Fast and Furious. The PAN primary, the National Action Party primary, and accommodations that took place in determining the Institutional Revolutionary Party and the Democratic Revolutionary Party candidates added drama, as did the campaign, in which security was still a huge issue. Beneath the surface, though, of Mexico's public discourse, attitudinal changes were taking place. Public safety began to recede as the candidates assured the public that they would not back down from the task of reducing criminal violence. And at the same time, issues of accountability, competitiveness, the waning utility of monopolies jumped onto the table. In the end, Enrique Peña Nieto, former governor of Mexico State and of the former ruling PRI party, was elected president by a comfortable margin of more than 3 million votes. But surprise of surprises, lame duck president Felipe Calderón shepherded a landmark labor reform bill through Congress and once inaugurated in December, Peña Nieto took on education reform, energy reform, and a number of other issues that we will hear about today. Now this man, who on the campaign trail could not name any books that he had read, is somebody who has rapidly taken charge and is directing Mexico in a different dynamic. To help us understand what has happened, I'm pleased to introduce today's distinguished panel. Luis Carlos Ugalde needs no introduction, really. Luis was president of Mexico's Federal Electoral Institute during the 2006 elections. He is director general of Integralia Consultores, a Mexico-based consultancy, and senior advisor to the Americas program. And also, he's the author of a new book, Por una democracia eficaz, radiografía de un sistema político estancado, 1977 to 2012. So he really has, I can't say numbers in Spanish, that's why I did that. But this is really the basis for understanding why some of the reforms are going on today and why the political parties are taking on a different direction. Manuel Suarez Meyer is an economist in residence at the School of International Service at American University. We're really grateful to have him with us today. He did his doctoral work at the University of Chicago and was the top economic diplomat in Washington at the time of the NAFTA negotiations. He was also chief of staff to the governor of the Bank of Mexico and more recently represented Mexico during the task of leading up to the negotiations leading up to the U.S.-Mexico Merida Initiative. So he has been present at a number of key points, key inflection points in U.S.-Mexico relations. Ambassador Jeffrey Davidow is another who needs no introduction. He's a retired diplomat, career ambassador who served in Africa and also in Latin America, and most notably as ambassador to Mexico and also Assistant Secretary of State for Western Hemisphere Affairs. He, too, is also an author, and we remember his fabulous book, The U.S. and Mexico, The Bear and the Porcupine. He's now a senior counselor with the Cohen Group. And finally, Dr. Duncan Wood was our senior associate in the CSIS Americas program, jumped ship. Now he is the new director of Woodrow Wilson Center's Mexico Institute, and congratulations on that, Duncan. Duncan has taught at the Instituto Tecnológico de México and is on the editorial board of Foreign Affairs Latinoamérica, and has been advisor to the newspaper La Reforma. Now, to get started, let's go ahead and start with you, Luis Carlos, on the evolution of Mexico's political system and what you can tell us about what may be the future of Mexico's political parties.
Good morning. Thank you very much for the invitation. And let me give first a very brief overview of what has happened in Mexico's democracy over the past 20 years or so far. As I argue in this new book, Por una democracia eficaz, my idea is that Mexico's clean elections and democracy, our short experience with democracy, has had a very limited effect on the quality of democracy, on the way the government performs and functions in Mexico. If we compare today's political system with that at the end of the 20th century, we will see that it is basically the same in nature, in the logic of its functioning. Clientelism, for example, is very much in good shape in Mexico. I would say even that after the alternation in Mexico's presidency in 2000, clientelism even got stronger. And therefore, we have today a clientelistic democracy. The rule of law is weak, as it was in the 20th century. It is not a priority in the minds of most politicians in Mexico. And I would say that, in general, Mexicans lack an esteem for legality. So legality is not a priority in the minds of Mexicans, and that has been pretty much the same over the past 20 or 30 years. The levels of impunity in Mexico continue to be above 90%, and probably with the arrival of democracy in Mexico, impunity has even increased, not only in terms of crimes, but also in political terms. In Mexico, the political system simply do not assign consequences to the way politicians perform. So it can be in Congress, it can be in political life in general, it can be the way state governors work. So you take decisions in Mexico and usually you do not pay for your actions, and therefore impunity continues to be the name of the game. There are obviously some achievements in Mexico. Pluralism has been a great achievement of Mexico's democracy, and there is more transparency and accountability in the national government, but not so much at the local level. So, in general, we may have clean elections in Mexico, we have pluralism, but the logic and the nature of the political system is very much the same as it was just 15 years ago. The two administrations of the alternation, those of Vicente Fox and Felipe Calderón, were unsuccessful in transforming and deepening the changes needed in the political system. In the case of Vicente Fox, probably, he didn't even try to make many more changes, with the exception of the Transparency Bill, which was promulgated in 2002. Nothing else happened. So if you see in an perspective the 12 years of the first two governments of the alternation in Mexico, very, very few changes occurred. There was a transparency bill, as I just mentioned, in 2002. There was a constitutional amendment in 2011 to strengthen the protection of human rights, very much important. There was a small political reform promulgated in 2012. And just weeks before the end of President Calderón's sexenio, I would say, major reforms began to occur. There was a reform to the accountability, to the Ley de Contabilidad Gubernamental, a bill to strengthen the accountability of state and local governments in Mexico, very important. And there was a new labor law, which I would say is very significant for the years to come. But in general, I would say that the political system in Mexico in the past 15 years has changed very, very little. Why? Why did Mexico not transform over the past 12 years? I remember in 2000 in Washington, it was a fashion to talk about a new beginning in Mexico. Vicente Fox became a very, very attractive politician worldwide, but after a few years in office, many began to experience some sort of frustration. Why? I would say that Mexico focused very much on holding clean elections as the route to a modern democracy. And this idea that clean elections was the main route to a modern democracy was a mistake. Many argued in those years that getting rid of the PRI was everything, and therefore that the problems in Mexico's politics was about people, not about institutions. And this wrong idea, I think it is behind the lack of transformation in Mexico. And I would say that probably behind Fox's perception and conception of Mexican politics was the idea that he was the change, and therefore nothing else had to be done. So what can we expect for the next sexenio? I would say that we can expect a wave of structural reforms in Mexico in various fronts: telecommunications, energy, social security, fiscal, education. Duncan Good will talk about this in his presentation. But I think that probably, if 2000 was the symbolic arrival of democracy in Mexico, as it was, an important moment, I think it was more symbolic than real. And I think that probably today, in 2012, 2013, real changes will begin to happen. It is not just about people, because I argue that the change in Mexico is not about people. It is about the moment in which real transformations will be made, probably to some rules of the game in the political system, and the deepening of some economic reforms that were initiated in the 1980s and 1990s. Probably we will see some action. I remember in 2000, I was talking in a seminar at American Society in New York in the month of March. It was about to be the anniversary of the first 100 days of Fox's new administration. And I said in that event, and I want just to read what I said, it is premature and even unjust to qualify Fox's first 100 days in office. But if I had to briefly define Fox's first 100 days in office, I would say it has been full of promises, programs, announcements, and great communication skills, but very few achievements and even some lack of direction. So Fox's actions in office were insufficient. It was full of promises, but few actions. And probably one of the new signs of the new administration in Mexico is that it is being full of actions rather than just announcements. And this is not just something that has been a credit of Peña Nieto's administration, but of political parties in general. I would say that some transformations are beginning to happen in Mexico, and it is the result of the confluence of the initiative of the administration, but also of the cooperation with the leaders of the PRD and the Partido Acción Nacional. I see two scenarios for the coming years in Mexico. Two scenarios. The first one is that this sexenio becomes the beginning of the most relevant period of structural and political transformations in Mexico's modern history. If 2000 was the symbolic arrival of democracy, the next sexenio can be the beginning of a period of real transformations of the political system, dismantling clientelism, fighting corruption, building a rule of law, promoting a culture of legality, and therefore improving the quality of democracy. That is the first scenario. The second one is that after an initial series of changes to the rules of the game, in education, in transparency, the administration focuses very much in its attention to economic reforms, leaving behind political ones. Energy reform, tax reform, and the shaking up of the social security system absorb the attention and resources of the new administration. Mexico becomes some sort of a rising star in the financial markets, and flows of investment stimulate growth in Mexico's, the strengthening of the exchange rate, and creates a sense of success and comfort. Therefore, if that happens, and it is likely that it will happen, this in Mexico. We will see some economic success and probably some sort of comfort in Mexico. This can be the major obstacle to change the political system. If we perceive that probably this can happen because there are some international confluence of factors, the fact that the BRICS are declining, the fact that there is a crisis in Europe, the fact that we have in Mexico domestic, the macroeconomic conditions in Mexico are in good shape, probably Mexico will be in the coming years a very attractive place for investment, and therefore we can see a wave of economic growth. But everywhere when you have economic success, consumption increases, the incentive to deepen political changes diminishes. So I think we will see some initial stimulus for political change. I think that the conditions are for changes and profound changes in Mexico. And I think that the decision to fight some vested interest in education, in telecommunications, is probably the most important and relevant change that we will see in the political system in the coming years. And finally, the fact that in contrast to the PAN initial clout, politically speaking, today's PRI has much more power than the PAN had 12 years ago. It has 19 state governors, the largest group in Congress, and that helps a lot in these initial moments of the administration. Thank you very much.
Luis Carlos, thank you very much. Short, compact, and loaded with information. Manuel Suarez Meyer, can you tell us where Mexico's economy has come from and what reforms are likely now on that scene?
Good morning, everyone. I'm charged to, as a good economist, to see the future. And we all know that economists are particularly incompetent at doing that. So whatever I say, please don't take it seriously, particularly if I do any forecasts. Stephen had given me an impossible job. He asked me to talk about Mexican economy since NAFTA and today's perspectives. What reforms are needed and which are likely, which will take us the next 3 days without any breaks. I will try to do all of that in less than 15 minutes, probably 12. So let's look at briefly what has happened since NAFTA in the Mexican economy. After the initial debacle of the December mistake in 1994, which I prefer to call the Cedillo mistake, although probably some people here in this table disagree with me, NAFTA was not even a year old, and the Mexican economy, after that initial bump, has had a mediocre evolution with rates of growth well below its potential. Mexico could have grown much faster, but what happened? Basically, that all the reforms that were done around NAFTA, opening of the Mexican economy, the privatization of a bloated and incompetent parastatal sector, government-owned corporations, that were producing close to a 20% deficit, 20% of GDP deficit. You had to get rid of that to have a functioning state. All of those reforms were very successful at improving the productivity of Mexico's economy, but then they stopped. After the Cedillo debacle, he spent the first 3 years of his administration digging himself out of the hole, which he had dug in only 19 days. And he had the brilliant idea of trying to pass structural reforms when the PRI no longer controlled Congress. And that was a serious mistake because none of those reforms passed. I'm talking about economic reforms. The political reform passed and we had the elections that Luis Carlos alluded. The PAN, the right-wing pan opposition, which had been the key element for crafting the previous reforms, did exactly the opposite role and played obstructionist in that period, 97 to 2000. And I contend also that Mr. Cedillo's idea of how to become anything but the bloat of black ink in the history books that he was going to become was to make sure that the opposition won the 2000 election. And therefore, he became the father of democracy. And this is very much what is heralded here in the US. The following 12 years of the two PAN administrations were a repetition of the last 3 years of Cedillo's administration. Same story, except that the filibustering role this time was played by the PRI, in large part due to the incompetence of Fox and Calderon, Calderon to a lesser extent, to forge opportunistic alliances with the PRI to pass reforms. Fox really thought that he was running for Queen of England. That was the job he wanted, to cut ribbons, to make the same speech over and over again. And that's not the way things work in Mexico. And he left all the threads of power fall, and as they fell, as we all know, the voids were filled by other people. And he was totally unable to comprehend what he had to do to make reforms. That was not the case of Calderon, but he also was unable to forge the necessary alliances. This, however, began changing in the last 3 months of the Calderon administration. Now, remember that on September 1st of last year, the new Congress took over. So it was not a lame duck Congress. It was the new Congress with a lame duck president. So that meant that the majority of the PRI congressmen and senators already were receiving instructions from Peña Nieto, the winning candidate, the president-elect, and President Calderón had the great opportunity of, in those 3 months, having an alliance de facto promoted by the PRI and Peña Nieto to pass reforms. In that brief period, they passed the always elusive labor reform that's essential to make the labor system far more flexible, to avoid endless and costly legal maneuvering in courts, to have universal free and secret ballots to elect union leaders, something the US wants to start debating in the opposite direction, interestingly enough, and regulations that make unions more transparent. Who opposed these reforms? The so-called left, which clearly by their acts show that they are to the right of Attila the Hun in real terms. A new accounting law that Luis Carlos already mentioned, that it's crucial because in the last 20 years, there has been an increasing level of scrutiny and control over what the federal government does in financial issues, but not at the state and local level. And this will hopefully change all of that. An education reform that will create a professional career path for teachers based on academic qualifications and rigorous exams. Not like today, in which you inherit the job from your parents. This is a sinecure which goes from parents to sons and daughters. Now, who opposed this reform? The unions. There are two unions. One, the official union, the famous or infamous Elvester Gordillo, and a far more radical to the left union, which opposes everything. So they have promised to wage war on reform and to try to block it. Now, reform changing structures of the government disappears. Several ministries, including public security, which becomes part of the Ministry of the Interior, Gobernación. That's crucial to give Gobernación back some power that was completely lost in the previous two administrations. Agrarian reform is transformed into something else. And a major burden to a well-functioning government, the public service ministry, Función Pública, also changes radically. Now, finally, the fifth and very important package that was approved by the lame duck, by the new Congress, but this already in December with President Peña Nieto in charge, was the Federal Budget and Revenues Act. And it was passed very smoothly, flawlessly. Normally, what Congress, Mexican Congress does is go to the wee hours of the last day of December and then declare that the first hours of January are still December, from a legal point of view, that they can do. And eventually, on the third day of January, pass something. This time, they could take vacations from holiday Christmas, because everything passed by the 20th of December. Now, let's look at what Peña Nieto has promised in the 2013 budget. He promised that there would be a zero deficit, fiscal deficit, down from 2.4% of GDP. Now, that 2.4% of GDP includes the investments done by Pemex, which are not counted in the official budget. So in reality, you have that 2.4%, but the legal budget deficit is only 0.4%. So he ordered a series of spending increases, a new crusade against hunger, universal pension for citizens 65 and older, insurance policy for female heads of family, starting the construction of a Mexico City Querétaro railroad, and investing in educational infrastructure, all of which cost something like half of 1 percentage point of GDP. So the job of the new Secretary of Finance had to do with increasing revenues or cutting spending by almost 1% of GDP. He was able to do it in the following way. First, and this had to be done with no new taxes. This was done basically by not lowering the income tax at, from 30%, as was had been promised at the previous administration, adjusting growth assumptions a bit upward. That mirrors. But they now are assuming a rate of growth for this year of 3.5%, and by adopting an expected price of Mexico's oil barrel of $85 per barrel and exports of 1.2 million barrels a day. Now, that's how they balance the budget into zero deficit. Remember, the real number is 2% deficit. Now, two good signs that give credibility to promised financial integrity followed in early January. The Secretary of Finance said 2 days ago that there would be no federal rescue for state and municipalities that are either bankrupt or getting there. And there are many states and local governments that are bankrupt. And the second is the monthly upward adjustment in the price of gasoline was the highest in 1 year and will help lower the subsidy that last year was close to $1.2 billion. Mexico's gasoline is highly subsidized because its adjustment doesn't follow international prices, but it's administered by the government. Now, finally, how worried should we be of the fiscal, economic, and political implications of Peña Nieto's Pacto por México? Because he promised and promised and promised things that we haven't yet accounted for. He actually made 95 commitments in his pact. 67 of those require legislative action, and 19 of them demand constitutional amendments. As you know, or as many of you know, we are more prone to change the constitution in Mexico than you are here in the States. Since 1917, we're about to have a 100-year celebration for our newest constitution. we've changed more than 500 times. So this is, you know, replaceable pages type of thing. So 17, he's proposing changes that imply 17 constitutional amendments. But the really tough ones, and Duncan is going to be talking more about them, are the fiscal reform that deals with taxation and spending. Here the problem is that we only tax about 12% of GDP, but the government spends about 20% of GDP. The difference being made by oil, Pemex. That makes the energy reform very difficult. So this is a catch-22. If you don't do a fiscal reform first, you cannot do energy reform because you need the money that is being transferred, all the Ricardian rent, to put a nice, elegant economic term, all the Ricardian rent is being appropriated by the government. So you have those two crucial reforms. And then competitiveness reform that includes fighting against all rent seekers that Peña Nieto alluded in his inaugural speech as poderes fácticos, powers that be. That's going to be a tough one, because that means that you have to confront Mr. Slim and remove the yoke that we all Mexicans have around paying tribute to Mr. Slim every single moment of our lives. If you have a cellular phone, if you have a phone at home, if you have a coffee in Sanborns, and all of those things means that you are paying a tribute to Mr. Slim, and that's going to be tough. The television networks included. Now, what's really worrying, and we should do the accounting on this, is that many of Peña Nieto's promises are trying to convert Mexico into a nice welfare state like Greece. Now, we know where Greece is. Do we want to go that path? He wants to make sure that the rights consigned in the Constitution are turned into accessible entitlements for the population. Now, depending on the quality of such entitlements, the fiscal cost of that could be 3%, 5%, 10%, 20% of GDP. Where is that going to come from? Now, my last comment here is, one thing that worries me enormously is the stubborn pursuit of a consensus. The Pact for Mexico was signed by the three main political forces. But the moment you start really dealing with the reforms that are necessary, particularly energy, the so-called left is going to leave. Why do you want a consensus? A democracy is built on majorities, and that's the way it should function. And the clear ally that Mr. Peña Nieto has is the PAN. Forget about the PRD and those bosses that are completely useless. So, what are the prospects? I think that economic point of view, the jury is still out, but we should have our calculators with us at each point and try to measure and weigh the cost of each of the promises as they try to become reforms. Thank you very much.
Manuel, thank you very much. Duncan, what do you have to add on the subject of reforms?
You have this set up here for me. All right, there we go. Thank you. Great pleasure to be here. Good morning to everybody. Special thanks to Steve and to Michael Graybill, who have worked with me closely throughout the 2 years of the Tinker Project and supported me and nudged me in the right direction whenever I needed it. And a special mention, of course, to Sidney Weintraub, who I began the project with before his retirement. It's fabulous to be in D.C. Many of you have been here much longer than I have. I've only been here 1 month, so I'm still in love with the place. I have to say, to be able to sleep at night without too much noise, to be able to wake up in the morning and not have immediate stress put upon me, to be able to walk the streets is a real joy. Having said that, I have a sick addiction to the Day FA, and I think I'm going to have to go back there a lot. Steve has asked me to talk about a number of issues here, and I'm going to try to be as quick as possible. He's asked me to talk about the prospects for reform, as the title said, and I'll get into that. But he's also asked me, just before we came into the room here, to talk about why reforms now? Why are reforms seen as being so crucial? That's been mentioned a couple of times already. And I think that earlier on, Luis Carlos mentioned the word eficaz. And I think that is a key word in understanding the current mood in Mexico, the political mood in Mexico. A large part of the rhetoric of the election campaign from Peña Nieto was about having effective government. It was about having a government which actually gets things done, which passes legislation. And that hit at the heart of many people's criticisms of both the Fox and the Calderón administration, that they were politically inept, that they weren't able to generate the consensus that was needed within Congress to actually get legislation passed. Another question, which I'm sure will come up, and maybe I'll leave this for the Q&A afterwards, is about, well, it's all well and good to actually pass legislation, but how about the implementation, the devil in those kind of details? And perhaps we can get to that, as I say, in the Q&A. Okay, so the story so far in the new government. I mean, we've really only had just over a month of the new government, and as has been already established, it's a very, very ambitious reform agenda. And these are reforms that are seen as being necessary, but also you begin to look at that legislative agenda over the next at least 3 years, and you say, well, how possibly are they going to fit all of this in? And I don't know if any of you saw this, but in the papers this morning, they published, you know, the agenda, the legislative agenda for the first 6 months. That's pretty packed already. Now, a lot of those issues that they're going to negotiate, and I can show that to you later on, but a lot of the issues that they're talking about negotiating and voting on can be grouped together. So there's a number of issues on energy reform, for example, that can be put into one package. But it shows that there really is a desire to put these reforms on the agenda. And I said earlier on that, you know, it's about being eficaz, it's about being an effective government, but it's also about sort of really hitting at the criticism that so many people within and outside of Mexico have made over the last 6 to 12 years, which is that, well, where is the change really happening? Aren't we still stuck where we were when the PRI left power, not just on the political front, but also on the economic front? My opinion on that is that in terms of the legislation, in terms of the regulatory frameworks, we have moved forward a substantial amount, but not enough. Clearly, the Mexican economy is a different kind of economy than it was 20 years ago. It's a much more modern economy, but it still suffers from many of the same sicknesses as it did back then. We've already had, as has been mentioned, a number of reforms that have already been passed. And just to talk very quickly about the education reform, it still has to be signed into law, of course, because it has to be approved by the states, but I don't think anybody predicts any kind of problem with that. I have to confess that when I was interviewed back in November and October of last year, and people said, what do you think about the chances for an education reform? I honestly said, why? Why would they want to go into that at this point? You know, maybe later on in the sexenio, but at the beginning, why would you want to alienate 1 million teachers? And I think that's a sign of the confidence, maybe hubris, but confidence of this government, is that they really feel as though they have the ability to generate support behind their proposals. And these are proposals which all of the major political actors in Mexico sort of coalesced around. I think that's an extraordinary achievement. And the education reform coming on top of the labor reform is very, very important in understanding, I think, the political mood in Mexico right now as well. And that is that success is breeding success on the legislative agenda. My feeling is that we have the labor reform, which had a slight hiccup sort of halfway through and then finally was actually produced, put onto the books. You then have the education reform, which is a constitutional reform, which everybody said would be incredibly difficult to negotiate, and came through like that. And you thought, well, my God, that is, if anything is gobierno eficaz, that is. I mean, that was extraordinary how quickly they went through. And maybe it was just the prospect of Christmas vacations and people wanting to get out of the day off. But I mean, really amazing how quickly that came through. And now there's, I think, a tide, a wave of optimism that this government can get issues through Congress. And that really leads into the next issue, which is the honeymoon period. My feeling is that internally, but more importantly, externally, Peña Nieto is enjoying a honeymoon period unlike anything we've seen for quite a long time. You know, Luis Carlos talked about Fox a lot, and that feeling internationally that Fox was the bringer of democracy to Mexico, and then there was that rapid deflation of that, particularly within the country and later on outside of the country. Although internationally, of course, Fox is still relatively well seen by people. Within Mexico right now, I think there's a feeling that the PRI is actually there to make a difference. Not necessarily that it has changed fundamentally from what it was before. Not necessarily that it's there to eliminate corruption or to guarantee security or welfare for all Mexicans, but actually to get things done. And, you know, Mexican voters last year were adamant about that. They really wanted to have a government that could get stuff done. The honeymoon period right now is intriguing in the sense that a lot of it is focused not actually on Peña Nieto, but on Videgaray and other government ministers. Peña Nieto has adopted a very statesman-like approach, spending a lot of time at the National Palace, making public appearances. I mean, he really is being presidential. And at the same time, behind the scenes, his team, as we all expected, is getting the job done for him. And I think that's a very, very good sign for his government in the sense that he's remaining relatively free of criticism. Now, there's lots of hurdles to overcome. There's lots of ways in which he can trip up, particularly on questions like security in the coming months. But he's moving along very nicely. And that brings me to the remaining major reforms for 2013, energy and fiscal reform. And it's already been discussed here. Why these two reforms are so important. And just a note here, most people have always said that energy and fiscal reform need to go hand in hand. You can't have one without the other because of the importance of Pemex's revenues for the government. They do need to go hand in hand. They both need to happen, but they don't necessarily need to happen at the same time. My assumption was always that energy would take place first of all, and then you'd get the fiscal reform, because I don't think you can negotiate the two things in the same session of Congress. I think they're just probably too complex as issues. I was thrown off a little bit yesterday. One of my former students called me, and he said that he's just been hired by the Secretary of Energy in Mexico to put together the energy reform proposal to be presented at the end of the summer for the fall. And I was like, wow, that goes against everything that I thought, because I thought that energy would come first. And then this morning I saw the newspapers with, of course, the legislative agenda, and energy does in fact come in the first semester. What are the prospects for reform? And I think we have to look here at the political outlook and the way things stack up in Congress. Although the Pacto por México is a peculiar creature, and you know, a lot of us are sitting here wondering exactly how it's going to play out. Was it just a public relations exercise? Does it continue to be a public relations exercise? The parties having a photo opportunity and being able to say, look, we're nice people, we work together, we're mature, we're going to get things done. Or does it actually mean something? Well, so far, and we haven't had much time to judge it, but it does seem to be moving the legislative agenda along. The opposition parties, the PAN and the PRD, are in a peculiar, although not unknown, situation. The PAN is divided internally. The PAN, you know, there's been all these news reports over the past week about them losing up to 80% of their members in different parts of the country. They're going through a sort of a soul-searching exercise and trying to work out exactly what their position is. The PAN at the moment is a weakened party, and I would say that actually does help the PRI on many issues in the Congress. I was worried that a divided PAN might play against an energy reform. It seems as though that may not be the case. Various people within the PAN have been coming out and saying, we're in favor of an energy reform, absolutely, as long as it increases private participation in the sector, which it reflects absolutely what Videgaray has been saying for months. The PRD is in an interesting situation as well, which is that now that Andrés Manuel is outside of the party, it frees them up in a way that they haven't been freed up before. And talking with PRD colleagues in Mexico City, in private, most of them will say, you know, we can't come out publicly and support questions of, you know, union transparency, the necessarily, you know, of increasing private participation in the energy sector, but we know how important they are. I mean, there are very, very few PRD politicians who, because of the way that the political system is structured in Mexico, can actually come out and say, we accept that these things need to happen in public. But behind the scenes, they many of them do. There's a lot of very reasonable people in the new PRD. And I think Manuel and myself might have a disagreement over this later on. But, you know, there's a younger generation of periodistas who are much more progressive and forward-looking and much more middle of the road than their predecessors. And I think it's interesting to hear what those people have to say. The PRI has generally been identified as being the obstacle to reform, in particular on the question of energy reform. People have said over the past 12 months, yeah, it's all well and good that the PAN comes on side and they provide the votes to get you over that two-thirds majority that you need in the Congress to pass a constitutional reform for energy. But what about the old-style PRIistas? What about the old guard? And again, I think we have to recognize that there has been a generational shift within the PRI. There's a lot of younger members who are in the PRI right now who accept that things do need to change. There's a lot of people within the PRI who have a different economic way of thinking. There's a lot of people within there's a lot of people who are no longer in the PRI who were vehemently opposed to any kind of energy reform in the past. And I'm talking here, of course, about the Manuel Bartlett's who have gone over to other political parties. And that, I think, is a shift which really matters. The vested interests, the poderes fácticos, that's something which was raised in an interview with myself the other day by a journalist from the UK. So how do you overcome those vested interests and who are they? Well, you know, the union, the Pemex union, is often seen as being sort of the big force that's going to oppose the energy reform if it involves an opening up of the sector. And what's interesting is that up to this point, they've been very, very quiet. They haven't sort of said anything against the idea of opening up the sector. But older and wiser heads than my own have pointed out to me that that's how unions work in Mexico. They play along to the last minute and then they say no. And that's where they really maximize their impact and they're able to negotiate. So that is an unknown quantity right now. Another vested interest, which I think we have to recognize, is the services companies that already exist and make good coin in Mexico, the Schlumbergers, the Halliburtons, who in 2008 were generally recognized to be against a more ambitious reform of the oil and gas sector, just simply because they thought they would lose out on the juicy contracts that they were getting from Pemex. Now they can turn that around, they can shift their perspective and see ways that they can make money under a new system, but that is a limiting factor. And lastly, public opinion. Public opinion has softened significantly on the question of energy reform and opening up, although we don't have any data on it. And this is one of the intriguing things. I've spoken with a number of people at GEA and Roy Campos I've spoken to. I said, why do you guys not have an up-to-date inquesta on Mexican public opinion on energy reform? And they say, yeah, that's a good idea. We should do that. So, well, you know, I know that certain private companies have contracted for that, but that's not publicly available information. I'm still trying to get my hands on reliable data. My feeling is just by viewing the public response to the proposals for or the discussion of energy reform last year is that Mexicans care a lot less about it now than they did before. Back in May, before the election, I started to see posters appearing in my neighborhood in Mexico City, a poster of Lázaro Cárdenas with oil rigs behind him, and the slogan was, ahora te toca a ti. It's like, you know, now it's your turn to actually resist the evil international oil companies coming in and taking Mexico's treasure. I saw one or two of them, and then nothing else. We haven't seen any demonstrations about it. We haven't seen anybody of importance coming out and really saying that this is a threat to Mexico. I think that you have an emerging consensus. Well, I know that we have an emerging consensus in Mexico that something needs to change dramatically in the oil and gas sector. What that change is disputed still. But you do have a broad consensus between the PAN and the PRI, and that really does matter. That makes a huge difference. And lastly, the question of timing here. The drivers, I think, are, you know, you have to get an energy reform through and a fiscal reform through before the honeymoon period is over. The negotiations with key actors are going to be fundamental, and the question is, how long does that take? Videgaray seems to be pretty certain that he's got the support of key players for energy reform already. Whether that's the way it plays out remains to be seen. I guess we'll begin to find out in February once the Congress comes back. Shaping the proposal. How is this proposal actually designed? Is it more or less ambitious? My feeling is it's going to be more ambitious. We're not talking about privatization, that word won't be used, but increasing private participation, absolutely. Will we get to production sharing agreements? Videgaray said yes, we will get to that. Whether or not that's possible in the first 6 months of this year is another question. Economic growth. As long as economic growth continues to be healthy in Mexico, I think that is a positive factor that we have to bring in when we're trying to understand whether or not the reform is going to go through. And lastly, production figures from Pemex. It's always interesting to see how and when production figures come out from Pemex and in what way they're presented. Is it that we've stabilized production or is it that we've stagnated production? This has been a debate over the past couple of years. You know, it looks as though production has slipped again slightly recently, but that often happens in December and January anyway, sometimes because of bad weather and things like that. It'll be interesting to see whether or not Pemex begins to report higher production figures as the previous government predicted it was going to do, or whether it actually sees lower figures. Two scenarios, energy in the spring, fiscal in the fall, or fiscal spring, energy summer fall. I talked about that a little bit earlier on. It seems now that we actually are going to have energy in the first 6 months of this year. And that's a link right there. I don't know if I can actually click on it, but it's from, I'm not actually getting any kind of, oh, there we go. Let's see if it comes up. Cannot locate the internet server. There we go. But if you, I'll leave a copy of this presentation, and hopefully it'll be on the Americas website, and then you can just click on that, and you see the actual legislative agenda as negotiated by the Pacto por México, and you see how many of the issues on there are actually directly related to energy. Many thanks.
Duncan, that was fabulous. The final word we give to Ambassador Jeffrey Davidow. I think the question we would ask you is, how would you characterize the change in U.S.-Mexican relations since 2000, and where are they headed?
Thank you, and thank you for the panel's excellent comments. Let me begin this way. I think if we were meeting today in Mexico City, much of the words of a similar panel would be familiar to what we've heard today. If they were talking about the United States, they would say that there is a general consensus in the United States that reform is necessary on major issues. There is, however, no general consensus on what the specifics of those reforms should be. And there is great doubt as to whether the political ineptitude of the system will be able to be overcome to produce in the United States important reforms that will leave this country in a changed, reformed state, as opposed to hard battles that will result in reforms that are partial or ineffective. And I think that question is paramount in Mexico, and I think it is paramount in the United States right now as we look at, and indeed it's even some of the same issues, particularly fiscal reform. But having said that, and that only serves to reinforce for me that despite the vast differences between Mexico and the United States and our histories and our political systems, we really are quite similar in some ways. There is the feeling in both countries that something new is needed. But as yet, there does not seem to me to be consensus on how to get there. In general terms, and I'll come back to this, because I think how each of the governments and people, but mostly the governments, deal with the reform issues in the other country will be very important and will require a great deal of care. And I'll explain that, I hope. Let me just say, and I think most of the people in this room understand this, that the relationship between Mexico and the United States is generally a good and healthy relationship. This is not always visible or understandable in terms of the daily press. The relationship is easily riled and easily bothered by specific issues, some quite important, some quite minor. But generally speaking, our relationship with Mexico is a good one. It has improved over the years, certainly has improved very significantly since NAFTA. And in the last sexenio, we saw levels of cooperation, particularly in terms of coordination and collaboration and cooperation in terms of security, that would have been absolutely unthinkable just a decade ago. The Calderon administration made a significant decision to cooperate with the United States in the anti-narcotics effort. And we can talk about, and maybe we will during the question and answers, how successful that was. But there is no question that the level of cooperation, the exchange of intelligence information, the training programs, the probable direct involvement of police from both sides in joint operations, although joint operations do not exist, but certainly joint intelligence sharing does. This was something that would have, as I said, been unheard of when I was ambassador a dozen years ago. Within this context of a generally good relationship, which doesn't always appear that way in the public mind, we have to think of how, as we deal with two new administrations, because I consider the Obama administration in its second term a new administration, how they will interact or how they should deal with each other as the two countries go through periods of very significant reform or attempts at reform. On the fiscal level, I think there is relatively little interface. If the United States manages to debate and get its house in order or not relating to our fiscal problems, and the same with Mexico, although I think in some ways Mexico's problems are less, these are not issues that are likely to become topics of bilateral, either public or governmental involvement. What the focus on these fiscal issues will do is to take our eye off the ball on of other important economic matters. The United States and Mexico should, in my view, be immensely dedicated to promoting trade and commercial integration. That's really the name of the game, in my view. We ought to be working very hard together to promote the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which is a new trading pact. I think the focus on individual fiscal issues, by individual I mean country-specific fiscal issues, is likely to diminish the available time and effort available for what is a really key question, which is integration and greater trade relations. But that is my perspective. Let's talk about some of the big issues of reform in each country, and with specific reference to how the other country should react and should be involved or should not be involved. Basically, my view is, if I were asked to give advice by either the Mexican government and the U.S. government. And just to set you all at ease, neither government is asking me, so you don't have to worry. I tell them to just shut up, sit down, and watch the process develop, and don't get involved in it. This may indeed be the position that the individual governments might take, but certainly in the kind of democratic systems that we have in both the United States and Mexico, which are very difficult to control, very difficult to put any order in terms of our respective congressional responses, and the press, of course, is totally uncontrollable. We will see, I am fearful, as we go through the respective reform mechanisms or reform efforts, too much commentary that will not be helpful. Now, let me be specific here. In the United States, we have two issues on our reform agenda, which will, I believe, prove to be highly contentious which will have implications, strong implications for Mexico. One, of course, is immigration, and the other is gun control. On immigration, there seems to be a consensus since the last election that something must be done. And even for obvious political reasons, there seems to be within the Republican Party an intent to do something. Beyond that, there's no real consensus. And once we get into it, and I think we will, I think President Obama is obliged to push the issue of immigration reform, we will find that all of the issues that have plagued every effort at this kind of reform, at immigration reform, for at least the last dozen years, will once again become apparent. What to do with the people who are already in the country, how to preserve and protect the borders, although anybody who studies immigration knows that the focus on the border is really only part of the issue. Most of the people who are living in this country, I would say, in an undocumented fashion, did not come across the border in the dead of night. They came across through international airports with visas that have now expired. But all of those issues, and there are a dozen others, which are embodied in the question of immigration reform, will be of immense interest to the public and government of Mexico. And we can depend upon our Congress to frame this debate in many occasions with language that is nothing but demeaning and insulting to Mexico. So, having said that, what should the Mexican response be? Well, I go back to my first point. Keep out of it. There is nothing that can be meaningfully added. This is a unilateral decision on the part of the United States. It's not going to be influenced by the perspective and the words and the actions of any other government. The same thing applies to guns. Now, in the last month or so, we have been focusing on this issue in this country because of reasons which are absolutely tragic that we all know about. This is not a new issue in the Mexican-U.S. relationship, and indeed, it has been a principal point of conflict over the past couple of years. That is, the lax gun laws in the United States allows for an inflow of heavy armament into Mexico. And the Mexican government and the Mexican population has complained consistently about this. It now appears that President Obama will, as an element of reform, and I think, quite frankly, events have pulled the administration toward having to do something about gun control. This will be a bitter, difficult, and once again, an ugly battle. And what should Mexico do about it? Well, I go back to my previous point. There is no real role for Mexico in this debate. There may be, at some point in the future, in both the gun debate and in the immigration debate, some minor rules for the Mexican government in terms of cooperation. Returning to the question of immigration, for instance, it does seem to me that if we're ever really going to get a handle on the question of, let's say, temporary workers' visas or different forms of immigration policy, some form of cooperation with the Mexican government in, let's say, establishing labor exchanges in Mexico that could be run by the government, managed by the government, would be useful. But that's down the road and do not really deal with the central issues that we're going to have to deal with. Similarly, if we look at the major issues of reform in Mexico, which Duncan and my other colleagues have talked about, it does seem to me that while these could be of extreme interest to the United States, particularly fiscal reform, because a strong and economically healthy Mexico is important to us, but even more so, energy reform. I think successive U.S. governments have done a good job in avoiding public comment on the specifics of energy reform in Mexico. And that should be continued, because our involvement can only be used by the opponents of energy reform to their advantage. Now, I do think the government of Mexico will take up the question of energy reform. It doesn't seem to be in doubt. What they will be able to do, how far they can go, how effective the reform will be, I think is all up in the air. From my perspective, the worst thing that could happen would be a long, difficult, politically divisive battle about constitutional reform as it relates to energy that actually turns out not to produce very much change at all. And that, I think, is a possibility. A horrible battle may be fought without really changing a great deal. So let me conclude by saying this. We are in a very interesting point in our relationship. Both countries have very significant reform agendas. How capable each country will be in developing effective change, I think, is quite open to question. I think the debates themselves and the focus on these issues will, unfortunately, take attention away from other topics that probably should be handled or discussed or reinforced. I mentioned trade as one of them. And almost inevitably, it seems to me, the results of the reform efforts, given the nature of our democracies, will be less, and maybe even much less, than those who are most actively proposing reform and change would like to see. So there will be a level of disappointment, both domestically and internationally. However, I do feel that the relationship, as I stated at the beginning, is a strong one. We will find ways to muddle through our disappointment, and both countries will be able to move ahead, and I hope to even deepen the relationship in the coming years. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now come to questions and answers, and I would ask if you do have a question for any of the panelists that you raise your hand. Wait for a microphone because this is being recorded, and also state your name and organization, and then who to whom you want to direct your question. Also, I do want to remind you that following the event, that we do have some copies of Luis Carlos's book, Por Una Democracia Eficaz, that are available, and we'll have a table set up where he will be able to sign them as well. I've already got my copy. So with that, let's start with the questions and answers. I think Michael.
Michael Masetic, PBS Online NewsHour. Am I wrong in thinking that the most remarkable thing about this discussion, and this is mainly for Mr. Ugalde, that how little the role of the United States is in this, is that people aren't sitting around talking about the United States the way they usually do in discussions about Mexico? And what makes me think of this particularly is that I was the foreign affairs producer on the NewsHour on September 7th, 2001, when we got basically the only major media interview with President Fox when he had this big glamorous visit to Washington. And in that interview, he put a lot of his chips on the table about a common labor market and all that. And then, of course, 4 days later, we had 9/11, and all that vanished. And in some ways, I think you're almost being a little unfair to him that a lot of his, the failure of his presidency, if it's such, really was because of external events like 9/11. And maybe he bet on the wrong horse or something. But anyway, it just, again, am I incorrect in thinking that we are really now talking Mexican issues in which the United States may be a bystander, but certainly is not anything like a central player?
Well, in my opinion, in terms of changes occurring in Mexico in the coming years, I think that the role of the U.S. Is best served by what Ambassador said, by just being very cautious about interfering in domestic debates, because in terms of the energy reform, for example, I would say that that will be the main reform in Mexico, probably, and the social security shaken up, bringing together all the systems that are now fragmented. And I would say that Mexico is best served by the U.S. being very, 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 very cautious in making a public opinion. But I would say that the U.S.-Mexico relationship will be changed just if Mexico begins to transform domestically, economically, and politically. I would say that the lack of transformation in Mexico makes it a very, makes it an irrelevant partner for the U.S. So when Mexico begins to change, economically speaking, I think we will be again as we were in the 1990s. Partner, an attractive partner for the U.S. So I think that the U.S. doesn't have a much important role to play in the coming months in terms of what will happen in Mexico domestically. That's my opinion.
Let's take three questions at a time. We'll start over here with George Grayson, and then we have two in front over here.
Thank you. I'm George Grayson from the College of William & Mary, and I'm also Professor Swazmir's probation officer, so I have to hear in a dual capacity. But I would like to ask Duncan, we're seeing now the reconcentration of power in Gobernación. It's going to have full control, apparently, over CSEN, the intelligence agency. SSP has been dissolved and is going into Gobernación, a gendarmerie of 10 to 30 various figures arise. 1,000 people is being talked about. What does this augur for a change in the security strategy of the country.
And over here.
Jorge Pinto, I'm a book publisher, former diplomat and public servant. And the question is to Duncan. And one thing that you mentioned at the end is the public opinion. And I wonder what the street, which means 132, AMLO, Bejaranos, Manuel Camacho, those who, in a way, do politics in the street, what are their role? What is the future of the street in Mexican politics?
Patricia.
Thank you. Patricia Escamilla Ham, Center for Hemispheric Defense Studies at National Defense University. My question is probably for Duncan and Ambassador Davidow. And given this new emphasis on the security strategy of the Peña Nieto government, what could we expect in terms of changes to the unprecedented military relations between Mexico and the U.S. during the past 6 years? Thank you.
Manuel, would you like to start?
I don't think there were any questions for me.
I think from your probation officer over here.
Oh, no, he was asking Duncan. So I see
but
the
feel
word.
Feel free to comment if you like.
Well, let me tell you that I think that...
But you are wearing your electronic bracelet, so we can chat.
I think that those were very necessary changes, and I commend Mr. Peña Nieto for doing them, because a toothless gobernación is completely useless. You might as well close it. So having now the teeth provided by a functioning federal police and a direct control over the CISEN, which is a Mexican version of the CIA, although they do mostly research rather than spying or killing people, I think that gives Gobernación a much stronger lever to deal with issues at state and local levels, where the chaos, financial and otherwise, brewed. So I think it's a great change.
Duncan.
Yeah, just to begin with, just to respond to something that Michael said earlier on, I think it's one of the dangers of us not talking about the United States as much is that I think that so many people, particularly here on the East Coast, don't get Mexico. They don't understand how important Mexico is for the United States. They don't understand how integrated our economy is with theirs. They don't understand how much American citizens depend on Mexico for jobs. They don't understand how important Mexico is going to be in the next 20 to 50 years in terms of making us competitive as a region within the world. Don't understand all these things. I think that's a real problem right now. You know, I've been in Washington for 5 weeks, so, you know, forgive me if I'm speaking out of turn. But, you know, the obsession with Iran, Iraq, Afghanistan, et cetera, it's like, what about that? I mean, that's a potentially really positive story that's happening right there. We need to understand that a lot better, I would say. So that was just a little comment there. George, the concentration of power in Gobernación, many people have said this is dangerous, that you're creating up a sort of a second government there. I'm not sure I see it in that same way, although the risk does exist. What does it augur for security was your specific question. I think that the potential for improving coordination between different agencies of the government, increasing information flows, and being on the same page at the level of the federal government at least, I think is great from this combining of different powers of government. Whether or not it has impact, it remains to be seen, because of course, you know, as we've discussed in many times, in many places at different times, is, you know, what exactly can the federal government do to reduce levels of violence in Mexico? Certainly, I think in terms of impacting on the bilateral relationship with the United States, having one agency that will be able to share information or not with the United States, I think is a positive step forward. It's always been commented on from the U.S. side of the border that it's confusing. Who do we talk to, and who can we trust? In this case, maybe it's that, well, you know, there's gobernación, you can't trust any of them. I don't know. But in this case, at least you'll know there's a clear path of where to go to. And I think that's a positive development. Jorge's question. Public opinion on the streets. I really like this question because it's a debate I've had with Mexican colleagues over the last 6 years. My feeling is that Mexican politics has changed fundamentally, and that the streets don't matter in the way they did before. It used to be that mass mobilizations on the streets, I mean, of course, thinking of 6 years ago and Andrés Manuel, but you know, before that, mass mobilization on the street, politicians would react to that. Look at what happened during the labor reform. I mean, they shut down San Lázaro, essentially. You couldn't get in or out. What did the politicians say? You know, but that's out there on the streets. We're inside. It doesn't make any difference. Now, if Andrés Manuel, 132, and various others take to the streets and they conduct a prolonged campaign, then that might bring it back to the forefront. What I doubt is that Andrés Manuel has the resources to do that anymore. I mean, he's cut off from resources from the DFA. He's cut off from resources from the PRD. So how is he going to finance any of this? Because back in 2006, he had to pay people to be there on the streets. And I don't see that sort of coming forward. But anyway, even if he was, I think the sense, the feeling of politics has changed in Mexico, and the streets don't matter in the way that they did before. And I thought, thank you, that was a great question. And Patricia, changes to military relations. I think that this is a really, really good question. I think it's one of the major concerns, obviously, up here, isn't it? And, you know, I've been asked this question since about 3 years ago. You know, is there, what if the PRI comes back? What if they change their approach? What does that mean for bilateral relations in military? Sedena is always a tricky beast because Sedena is so closed. Sedena does not want to open up to the outside world, does not want to share information, does not naturally, I mean sort of inherently, doesn't want to engage in even sort of communication with other militaries. That's how it's traditionally been. But there is a slight shift taking place in there that has increased over the last 6 years, I would say. Part of it is generational. As younger cadres come through, they're much more open. They've been educated in a different way than the older generals. And you're seeing there, it's small little signs, attending conferences that they didn't used to go to, sending higher level people, engaging more and more in conversations with other military forces. That's an intriguing possibility. I think that institutional change within the Mexican military needs to be nurtured, and that's where the danger lies, I would say, is that if the Peña Nieto government isn't willing to invest in that, to really try to pull them out even further, then it could fall back to the way it was before, although the generational shift offers us a more optimistic outlook. What is certain is that the Navy is very, very positive about military cooperation, and they are always there at the table, sort of poking the army, saying, look, we got to do some sort of joint exercises, we got to go out and we got some new equipment, we got international exposure. And the army increasingly has sort of, they used to just reject, they say, well, that's what you do, we're the real military institution in the country. Now I think the army is saying, you know what, we'd like to have a little bit of that.
Ambassador Davidoff?
The real issue to me seems less than to be one of military-to-military cooperation. That has been important, and it has grown. But the real hub of activity with security forces in Mexico has been U.S. civilian agencies, particularly DEA, FBI, Homeland Security, with the military. And in this regard, Duncan is absolutely right. The Navy has been in some ways easier to work with than the Army. They are, as you all know, separate ministries. And the relationship between those U.S. civilian agencies, including the CIA, with their Mexican counterparts. Now, the reorganization in putting most of these, except the military, under gobernación may be a very important development in terms of efficiency and what have you. The real issue, it seems to me, is whether the level of cooperation that we've seen and effectiveness in many cases will be able to continue. And I think that is a very major issue because if, and we've seen this before in the United States, if the relationship between the American civilian agencies and their counterparts in Mexico is damaged, becomes less full, becomes hostile, that could have an impact on many other elements of the relationship that go quite beyond in different directions than security. So I think one of these issues, that when we talk about reform in Mexico, that will have an impact on the relationship with the United States is this whole question of restructuring the security services and how they then interact with their American counterparts. The military to military is important, but less important than what I've just said.
We have time for just two more questions, if they're brief. So I think we have one gentleman here and one gentleman in the back of the room.
Hi, Dennis Gilbert, Hamilton College. The one issue that we have not touched on is one that I gather was one of the big drivers of the election, and that is the drug trade and criminal violence. I wonder what the panel has to say about Peña Nieto's plans in that area.
I think on the other side.
Stephen Donahue from McLarty Associates, for Luis and Manuel mainly, but anybody else can comment. What is the impact of all of this on El Bastard and the Panal, and do you really expect the education reform to make a difference in education in Mexico?
Gentlemen.
Well, let me take on this question and make a very, I make an argument. Changes are occurring in Mexico in education, in labor. I think we will see some changes in telecommunications and transparency. But the real question is the ability of political parties and the new administration to push energy, tax reform, and social security, because there is consensus. It is very easy to be in support of the education reform, but it is more difficult to be in favor of energy tax or social security. So if the Pact for Mexico has been successful in the past few weeks, it is because it's very popular to be against El Bester Gordillo or to be in favor of a better education in Mexico. So honeymoon is possible in these conditions. But once the energy bill comes to the floor in the Mexican Congress, I think the honeymoon will be over. And if we want to have a very effective energy reform or in terms of the tax reform, it is impossible to have consensus. So in my opinion, the honeymoon will be over at some point in this year. And it is because energy and tax reform are very divisive, as it is evident in the US. So the question is not whether we will have some reforms. We are having them. The question is whether there will be enough votes to have an effective and comprehensive energy bill probably in the fall in Mexico. And second, whether that will be implemented in the coming years. Because as you mentioned, well, everybody is talking about the education bill, and the education bill will be promulgated in the coming weeks. But the implementation of that bill will take years to be effective and to have a real transformation in the Mexican education system. So the question is, how effective will that implementation process will be in the coming years? Because everybody celebrates reforms, structural reforms, but those reforms are really effective when they get to the school level, and that will take years to have an impact.
Ambassador, comments?
Two comments, one on energy reform and one on the question of violence. I agree that with Luis Carlos that when the battle is essentially joined in the Mexican Congress over the question of energy reform, which will require some sort of constitutional amendment and a two-thirds vote, there will not be unanimous consensus. Indeed, I think if there is total consensus, then the likely reform will probably not be worth. Oh, I'm sorry. What I was saying is there will be a tremendous amount of battle in the Congress. I doubt that there'll be a total consensus. And indeed, if there were a total consensus, the likely reform would probably not be worth very much anyhow. So as I said earlier, I think the administration of Mexico has to make up its mind. If it's going to move ahead on energy reform, it really should try for some very significant reform, not for minor reform that will probably also require a very heavy battle, and at the end of the day will not result in very much being done. In terms of the question of violence, clearly I think for the Mexican public the issue is not will there be more or less drugs flowing into the United States. That is not, I think, particularly an issue that is of concern. The real question is the level of violence. And will the new administration and with the new security apparatus that are being created, will this lower the level of violence? Not only the horrific fighting among the cartels that has left so many thousands of people dead, but generally violence as it applies to individuals in their daily lives, the level of extortion, the level of kidnappings, the level of just bad guys on the street. And that will be, I think, the principal way that the Mexican public judges the Peña Nieto regime. Are they 2, 3, 6 years from now any safer in their lives than they are today? So it's a very important issue.
Manuel?
Yes, it's clear that the Peña Nieto is going to approach the issue of the war against drugs in a completely different manner than Calderón. And he's not going to go for the decapitation policy that was followed in the previous 6 years. And he's going to basically declare victory, move on, and fight violence. I think that's the issue. And that might turn out to be not all make certain agencies in Washington not all that happy. Now, in relation to Elbester, she's been around since her predecessor was kicked out by President Salinas some 30 years ago, 20 some years ago. And she's powerful, but I think that she can be dealt with quite effectively. Because an effective Ministry of Gobernación has the information that can be used to deal with her and persuade her to cooperate or replace her. Everyone said that Laquina, the famous or infamous leader of the oil workers, could not be touched. He had real power. Well, he was dealt with very effectively in the first month or so of the Salinas administration. I think the same can be done with labor leaders in this administration.
Duncan, final word.
Yeah, I just want to say one quick thing about the energy reform. The PRI is quite aware there's going to be a divisive issue. I had a conversation with David Pencina, who is the president of the Senate Energy Commission, back in November. And he said, look, we're going to have to invest an enormous amount of political capital in getting the energy reform. We may as well make it an ambitious energy reform rather than an unambitious energy reform because it's going to be divisive anyway. And he said, and we're willing to do that. And if you sort of combine that with comments from other priests such as Videgaray, who say, you know, if we didn't believe we had the votes, we wouldn't be suggesting these things. And he's repeated that on a number of occasions. I think that gives you an idea. They know it's not going to be unanimous. They know that this is not about consensus, but it's about generating enough of a consensus between enough votes or amongst enough votes to actually get the legislation passed.
Thanks to our panelists, Luis Carlos Ugalde, Ambassador Jeffrey Davidow, economist Manuel Suarez Meyer, and newly appointed director of the Mexico Institute at the Woodrow Wilson Center for Scholars, Duncan Wood. Thanks very much for being with us today. And to our audience, I would like to invite you to please come up and talk with the panelists. And if you're so inclined, to please purchase a book. Thank you.